Alright guys, with that chapter done, I can finally read this. I've read Asylum research before last year, in the winter I think, but it didn't come out well. It was out of sync I think when I was trying to make a story narrative out of it. Yeah, but that didn't work out. My last tablet was just dumb. Alright. Asylum in the United States. So this might be a little too data for some people towards the end, so you can pause the video if you need to, 'cause I won't get too data specific with you guys, 'cause I don't want to look like a fool, and I don't want to confuse anyone. I don't want to confuse myself. I mean, history's already confusing and messed up as it is, so all right. Each year, thousands of people arriving at our border or already in the United States apply for asylum, a form of protection from persecution. Asylum seekers must navigate a difficult and complex process that can involve multiple government agencies. Those granted asylum can apply to live in the United States permanently and gain a path to citizenship, and can also apply their spouse and children to join them in the United States. If you saw the dramatized version of the video I tried to show that was out of sync, Rotten Dead Leaves Into Now, Chapter 8, I think. That was stupid. It showed a dramatized version of what actually apparently happens, where children are literally having to defend themselves to a judge. So, these people are barely 10 years old sometimes, and they don't even know what any of this political crap is, so they're put into the crossfire, so all right. Okay. This fact sheet provides an overview of the asylum system in the United States, including how asylum is defined, eligibility requirements, and the application process. Sorry about that. All right. What is asylum? Asylum is a protection granted to foreign nationals already in the United States or arriving at the border who meet the international law definition of a refugee. The United Nations 1951 Convention and 1967 Protocol define a refugee as a person who is unable to or unwilling to return to his or her home country and cannot obtain protection in that country due to past persecution or well-founded fear of being persecuted in the future on account of race, in quotes, religion, nationality, membership in a particular social group, or political opinion, end quote. Congress incorporated this definition into U.S. immigration law and the Refugee J Act of 1980. Asylum is technically a discretionary status, meaning that some individuals can be denied asylum even if they meet the definition of a refugee. For those individuals, a backstop form of protection known as withholding of removal may be available to protect them from harm if necessary. As a signatory to the 1967 Protocol and through U.S. immigration law, the United States has legal obligations to provide protection to those who qualify as refugees. The Refugee Act established two paths to obtain refugee status, either from abroad as a resettled refugee or in the United States as an asylum seeker. How does the asylum system help people from fleeing persecution? An asylee, or a person granted asylum, is protected from being returned to his or her country, is authorized to work in the United States, may apply for Social Security card, may request permission to travel overseas, and can petition to drag family members to the United States. Asylees may also be eligible for certain government programs such as Medicaid or refugee medical assistance. After 1 year, an asylum may apply for lawful permanent resident status, i.e., a green card. Once the individual becomes a permanent resident, he or she must wait 4 years, sorry, to apply for citizenship. Man, the context there must have been confusing if that was only on audio. Okay. What is the asylum application process? There are three primary ways in which a person may apply for asylum in the United States: the affirmative process, the defensive process, and the expedition process. Affirmative asylum: a person who is not in removal proceedings, or a person who has been designated as an unaccompanied child, even if in removal proceedings, may affirmatively apply for asylum through U.S. citizenship and immigration services. USCIS, Division of the Department of Homeland Security, DHS. If the USCIS Asylum Officer does not grant the asylum application, and the application does not have the lawful immigration status, he or she is referred to the immigration court for removal proceedings, where he or she may renew the request for asylum through a defensive process and appear before an immigration judge. So maybe I'm wrong here, and this is a different context of the situation, but yeah, people under 10 literally have to represent themselves in front of a judge, and they have to wear, like, this headset so that they can hear the language filter to the language they can hear. You know, instead of the judge learning the language, because there's some judges that they know the C at, you know, the yes, but you know, they're not really, like, apparently educated, because they need the technology on the other end to hear the machine, you know, speaking to the asylum seeker, which is pretty sad and messed up, but whatever. Defensive asylum: a person who is in removal proceedings may apply for asylum defensively by filing the application for an immigration judge at the Executive Office for Immigration Review in the Department of Justice. In other words, asylum is applied for as a defense against removal from the U.S. Unlike the criminal court system, EOIR does not provide appointed counsel for individuals in immigration court, even if they are unable to retain an attorney on their own. All right, expedited asylum. A person taken into custody within 14 days of entering the United States who is placed into expedited removal proceedings may be put through a new process begun in 2022, which allows a USCIS asylum officer to review and abdicate their asylum claim before they are placed into formal removal proceedings. Individuals put through this process who are denied asylum as referred to the immigration court for removal proceedings and further expedited hearings on their asylum application. Asylum seekers who arrive at the U.S. port of entry or enter the United States without inspection generally must apply through the defensive or expedited asylum process. All three application processes require the asylum seeker to be physically present in the United States or at a port of entry. So, in other words, they have to do the thing that nobody wants, which is just come right on in, you know? And that's where they can approach a type of asylum process where it makes them look sketchy, but this is technically legal. So, I feel like this is kind of weird, because I feel like this is, even though I feel like immigration should just be, you know, whatever and free going, but I wonder if this is just like an optics game. You know, you make the immigrants look, again, you know, you get them to look all scraggly, you withheld them from certain medications, you burn all their shit, and so, and then you have them come right on in, where, into the part of the United States where people will just transport you somewhere else because they don't want you. Like, how messed up. Okay. With or without counsel, an asylum seeker has a burden of proving that he or she meets the definition of a refugee in order to be granted asylum. An individual is required to provide evidence demonstrating either that they have suffered persecution on account of protected grant in the past or that they have a well-founded fear or future persecution in their home country. An individual's own testimony is usually critical to his or her asylum determination. Certain factors bar individuals from asylum. For example, with limited expectations, individuals who fail to apply for asylum within 1 year of entering the United States will be barred from receiving asylum. Similarly, applicants who are found to pose a danger to the United States, who have committed a particularly serious crime, or who persecuted others themselves, are barred from asylum. You could just be ironic and, like, put them in our private prisons. Like, wouldn't we love that? You know, you'd make them think they're coming in to be free in our country, and then it's just like, well, you're a criminal, so you know what happens to criminals in the United States. We would, I bet you people in the prison industry have tried that, and, like, I don't know, maybe it would be too easy. I don't know. That's so weird. I'm shocked the prison industry wouldn't jump on that. All right. Is there a deadline for asylum applications? An individual generally must apply for asylum within 1 year of their most recent arrival in the United States. In 2018, a federal district court found that DHS is obligated to notify asylum seekers of this deadline in a class action lawsuit that challenged the government's failure to provide asylum seekers adequate notice of the 1 year deadline and uniform procedure for filing timely applications. Asylum seekers in the affirmative and defensive process face many obstacles to meeting 1 year deadline. Some individuals face traumatic persecutions, from their time in detention or journeying to the United States and may never know that a deadline exists. Yeah, I bet you they don't tell them, obviously. Even those who are aware of the deadline, encountering systemic barriers such as lengthy backlogs that can make it impossible to file their applications in a timely manner. Well, of course. Make it hard, obviously, for some reason. Jesus. Why am I not surprised? Like, anyway, you know, you're not even a citizen yet being persecuted for being another, and you're already being jumped through hoops. All right. In many cases, missing the one-year deadline is the sole reason for the government denies the asylum application. Under the expedited asylum process, a person who passes a credible fear interview is considered to have applied for asylum, which means that the one-year filing deadline is automatically satisfied. What happens to asylum seekers arriving at the U.S. border? From 2004 through March 2020, DHS subjected most non-citizens who are encountered by or presented themselves to a U.S. official at a port of entry or near the border to expedited removal, an accelerated process which authorizes DHS to perform rapid removal of certain individuals to help ensure that the United States does not violate international and domestic laws by returning individuals to countries where their life or liberty may be at risk. Oh, that's nice of us, I guess, right? I mean, I'm honestly shocked about that. Okay. Credible fear and reasonable fear screening processes are available to asylum seekers and expedited removal processes. Importantly, while the process described below is how asylum seekers should be processed under law, at times CBP officers do not properly follow this process. Additionally, under the Trump administration, asylum seekers were subjected to various new asylum policies in 2019 and 2020, which are described in greater detail below. Since March 2020, asylum seekers also have been expelled under Title 42, a pandemic health-for-health policy in which individuals are not permitted to seek asylum. In some circumstances, if DHS does not have the capacity to hold a person in detention for a credible fear interview, they are instead released directly at the border. Individuals who are released this way are generally provided a notice to sorry, itchy. To appear in a court where they have to go through the defensive asylum process, including a requirement to file an asylum application. Okay. Credible fear. Individuals who are placed in expedited removal proceedings who tell a Customs and Border Protection CBP officer that they have fear of persecution, torture, or returning to their country, or that they have wished to apply for asylum, should be referred for credible fears screening interview conducted by an asylum officer. If the asylum officer determines that the asylum seeker has credible fear of persecution or torture, it means that the person has proven that she or he has a significant possibility of establishing eligibility for asylum or others protection under the Convention Against Torture. Wow. Well, that's specific, but good. What happens next, then, depends on whether they are placed into the old pre-2022 process or the new post-2022 expedited asylum process, which, as of publication, was only in use on a limited pilot basis. Those placed in the old process which pass a credible fear interview are referred to immigration court to proceed with the defensive asylum application process. These placed in the new expedited asylum process who pass a credible fear interview are referred back to USCIS for a separate asylum merits interview. At this interview, which is supposed to occur within 21 to 45 days of the credible fear interview, the asylum officer will determine whether or not to grant the person asylum. If the person is granted asylum following the asylum merit interview, the process is complete. If the asylum officer determines following the asylum merits interview that a person does not qualify for asylum, they are referred to immigration court to proceed with the defensive asylum application process on a significantly more rapid schedule than is designed to have the court process completed with 6 months. Okay. If the asylum officer determines the person does not have a credible fear, the individual is ordered removed. Before removal, the individual may appeal the negative credible fear decision by pursuing a truncated review process before an immigration judge. I mean, that's good, I guess. It still doesn't seem likely that you're going to get here. But it's good they give you, like, an option to say something against it. All right. If the immigration judge overturns a negative credible fear finding, the individual is placed in further removal proceedings through which the individual can seek protection from removal, including asylum. If the immigration judge upholds the negative finding by the asylum officer, the individual will be removed from the United States. In fiscal year 2019, the last full year before COVID-19 pandemic, ISCIS found 72,252 individuals to have credible fear. These individuals, many of whom were detained during the screening process, will be afforded an opportunity to apply for asylum defensively and establish that they meet the refugee definition. The number of credible fear cases has skyrocketed since the procedure was implemented. In fiscal year 2009, USCIS completed 5,523 cases. Case completions reached an all-time high in fiscal year 2019 at 102,204. Reasonable fear. Individuals who re-encounter the United States unlawfully after a prior removal order, the non-citizens convicted of certain crimes are subject to different expedition removal process called reinstated of removal. To protect asylum seekers from summary removal before their asylum claim is heard, those in reinstated of removal proceedings who express a fear of returning to their country are afforded a reasonable fear interview with an asylum officer. To determine a reasonable fear, the individuals must show that there is a reasonable possibility that he or she will be tortured in the country of removal or prosecuted on the basis of race, religion, nationality, political opinion, or membership in a political social group. While both credible and reasonable fear determinations evaluate the likelihood of the individual's prosecution or torture if removed, the reasonable fear standard is higher. If the asylum officer finds that the person has a reasonable fear of prosecution or torture, he or she will be referred to immigration court. The person has the opportunity to prove to an immigration judge that he or she is eligible for withholding of removal or deferral of removal, protection from future prosecution or torture. While withholding of removal is similar to asylum, some of the requirements are more difficult to meet, and the relief it provides is narrower. Significantly, and unlike asylum, it does not provide a pathway to lawful permanent residence or citizenship. If the asylum officer determines the person does not have a reasonable fear of future persecutions or torture, the individual may appeal the negative decision in an immigration court. If the judge upholds the asylum officer's negative determination, the individual is turned over to immigration enforcement. Turned away to immigration enforcement officers for removal. Okay. However, if the immigration judge overturns the asylum officer's negative finding, the individual is placed in removal proceedings through which the individual can pursue protection from removal. Fiscal year 2019, the last full year of the pandemic, found 3,306 individuals to have found reasonable fear. Okay. Changes to the asylum process at the border during Trump administration and afterwards. In April 2018, the Trump administration issued guidance formalizing a prior policy of turning away asylum seekers at the U.S. border under metering. Asylum seekers are told to wait in Mexico, usually placing their names on a list, until CBP officers determine that a given port of entry has a capacity to process them. Through metering, asylum seekers were prevented from accessing the asylum process which they arrived at the U.S. border. In November 2021, the Biden administration formally rescinded this guidance and instructed ports of entry to expand asylum processing. However, due to pandemic-related restrictions of ports of entry, this new guidance has not fully gone into effect at a time of publication. In January 2019, DHS began implementing a series of new programs that significantly altered the traditional credible and reasonable fear processes. Most of these programs, including so-called asylum cooperative agreements and rapid credible fear education processes known as PACR and HARP, were suspended in March 2020 due to the COVID-19 pandemic and were later formally revoked by the Biden administration. Okay. The most prominent of these processes, known as the Migrant Protection Protocols, or Remain in Mexico. Oh, I've heard of this. Only once, honestly. Okay, sorry. Forced asylum seekers to be sent back to Mexico, where they were required to wait for the date of their immigration court hearings, held at four different U.S. locations across the border. Individuals put through MPP did not go through the credible fear or reasonable fear screening, but instead were put directly into court proceedings, which allow U.S. officials to send them back to Mexico to await their subsequent court hearings. The MPP was originally struck down by the Ninth Circuit at the violation of as a violation of the law, but that decision was put on hold by the Supreme Court. Roughly 68,000 to 70,000 people were put into MPP through January 2021 when President Biden took office and suspended the practice. In June 2021, the Biden administration formally terminated MPP. However, in 2021, the federal court in Texas ruled that this termination was improper and ordered the administration to resume MPP in decision. In December 2021, and Biden administration reached an agreement with Mexico to resume the program. Although in a significantly more limited fashion than the original program, the lower court's order was eventually overturned by the Supreme Court in June 2022, allowing the Biden administration to terminate MPP a second time. Over 6,000 people were returned to Mexico under the renewed MPP 2.0 litigation over the Biden administration's second attempt to end the program remains ongoing at a time of publication. Alright. Changes to the asylum process due to COVID-19. In March 2020, in response to the coronavirus pandemic, the Center for Disease Control issued an order suspending the introduction of persons who have been in coronavirus impacted areas. Citing this authority, the Border Patrol began expelling individuals who arrive at the U.S.-Mexican border without giving them the opportunity to seek asylum, even if they express fear of persecution. That order was later extended indefinitely. Additionally, in response to the pandemic, all PPP hearings at the border were suspended until January 2022, when hearings resumed a following court order. Since Title 22 went into effect in March 2020, CBS agents have carried out over 2.2 million expulsions. Expulsions under Title 42 are carried out under the public health authority, do not involve immigration law, including asylum law. That means the individuals who are expelled under Title 42 are generally not permitted to ask for asylum. Although there are some exceptions, for example, due to federal class action lawsuit, which went into effect in spring 2022, individuals who arrive as members of the family group and who express fear of persecution in the country to which they would be expelled are generally permitted to seek asylum. Since March 2020, over 230,000 people arriving in a family group, primarily from Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, have been expelled under Title 42. Tens of thousands of asylum seekers who arrived as single adults have been expelled, with over 10,000 Haitians along have been expelled back to Haiti. Asylum seekers have also largely been blocked from seeking asylum at ports of entry thanks to Title 42, which has forced many to cross between ports of entry and instead rather wait indefinitely in dangerous conditions in Mexico. Due to logistical and diplomatic reasons inherent to Title 42, most asylum seekers from countries either from Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras, or El Salvador cannot be expelled, and have been permitted to seek asylum in the United States through the defensive or expedited asylum process. How long does the asylum process take? Overall, the asylum process can take years to contribute. I cannot read today. What is going on? It takes years to conclude. In some cases, a person may file his or her application or pass a credible or reasonable fear screening and receive a hearing or interview date years in the future. Backlogs, which were already long before the pandemic, have only grown longer since the then due to COVID restrictions and months or years long closures in some courts and asylum officers. Oh, that's really sad. People's livelihoods are just tossed out because of this. Okay. As of April 1st, 2022, there were 4,786 affirmed asylum applications pending. The ICIS, the program, does not estimate the time it will take to schedule an initial interview for the asylum applicants, though historically the delay could reach 4 years. The number 4, by the way, just in case you're listening. Okay, the backlog in the U.S. immigration courts continue every month to reach all-time highs. With over 1.82 million open removal cases of June 2022. Through November 2021, asylum applications have been filed in over 6,071,000 removal cases, with the average case pending for over 4 years. Individuals in the immigration court case who were ultimately granted relief, such as asylum, by May 2022 had waited more than 1,508 days on average for that outcome. Illinois had the longest wait times, averaging only over 2,000 days until the relief was granted in the immigration case. Damn, that's a long time to wait. What the hell? Man, if these people had any pets or things just waiting in the hot sun, it's probably all, like, ruined or they're dead or... Again, they better not... Like, people bring stuff with them, like, you know? Okay, well, I don't know if you can take pets through Border Patrol. I have no idea. That may sound stupid. Maybe you can. All right. See you for now.